Welcome. The Lord be with you and also with you. Today we're beginning a series of talks and reflections on our walk with God in a post-COVID world. And of course, one of those main factors that we've discovered is that the world into the future will look much more technologically savvy. We'll be zooming around and doing things very differently, particularly in the workplace. There's lots of other things that have arisen through lockdown, and even as lockdown is eased, we're beginning to reassess the way life will be. And we hope to feed into that and what it might mean in terms of our Christian discipleship. But let's begin by singing together.
Who I am, It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. 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 You are perfect in all of your ways.
Later on in our worship, we'll be sharing together in bread and wine. I'll be saying the Eucharistic prayer over some bread and wine, and it will include the bread and wine that you've gathered for yourself. So if you need to get yourself ready for that, then please do pause the video now and go and get some bread and wine for yourselves. Jesus said, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. This is a helpful way of considering confession. It's not a destructive act. It's a pruning act, which is to bear fruit. So as we confess our sins and as he deals with things and as he forgives us, it is for the purposes that we might be even more fruitful, ever more fruitful. And as we confess our sins together, whenever I say, Father, forgive us, you respond with, save us and help us. For turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives, Father, forgive us. For behaving just as we wish without thinking of you, Father, forgive us. For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, forgive us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us. Father, forgive us. For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son. Father, forgive us. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As God's forgiven people, let's turn to him in song.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all see how great is our God. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Beginning at the end, our God, and all will say how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And this is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my
let's respond to God as he is appearing to us through those worship songs. We wait for him and we enjoy him. And now is a moment to make your requests known to God. My sense is that what is God is calling us to now, just in our hearts, to ask the thing that is there. Not the thing that ought to be there, or perhaps that has been there on other occasions, but what's there now? What's the cry of our hearts now? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy upon us. We welcome your Spirit upon us in our homes and in our nation. Work with us in these days and walk alongside us always. Amen. Our worship continues now with a short interview from one of our young people, one of our very talented musicians who's been helping us in our music team for a long time, but in particular with the videos lately. So over to Ollie.
Hi, Ollie. We're really grateful that you've been back to play for us on our videos, and you always look super cool on the ones we've recorded. Is this effortless, or do you take great effort with your hair and everything?
I don't really pay attention to it, really. Don't laugh.
And obviously everyone's talking, so it's quite hard to hear the interview. What have you got to say to Christchurch? Because you're about to go back to uni, aren't you?
Yeah. Just want to say hi, everybody. That's probably it.
And has it been okay, lockdown?
Yeah, it's been fine. You just play music on my own. It's kind of all right. My brother punches me a bit.
Does he?
Yeah, that's most of it.
And it's his birthday today, isn't it?
Yeah,
so it is. We're doubly grateful that you've been out.
Yeah, he's turning 24. That's weird.
But music's your thing, isn't it? That's what you're studying.
Yeah, trying to, yeah.
And compositions, is that what you're doing?
I major in compositions, yeah.
And you've got a girlfriend?
Yeah, I do.
Is it still the same one?
Or have you got still more than the
one?
Same one.
Shamira?
Shamika.
Shamika.
Yeah, it's been about 3 years and 9 months or something, yeah. About that. So, good, that's a good boyfriend, I know.
That's really nice. So,
yeah.
And so is she, she's not at Nottingham with you though, is she?
No, she's not. She's in Harford. Yeah. Right. But, yeah. Hope everyone's well.
Okay, yeah, thanks, Ollie. You're kind. Thank you.
I'm so awful at that. Oh, is it still going?
Our worship continues now with a reading from Scripture, and then John, one of our licensed lay readers here, is going to speak to us from that reading. And indeed, he's introducing our series now of what life looks like in a post-COVID world. What opportunities does it present for us as Christians, and how to live differently as disciples?
Hello, I'm John Truscott, a member of Christ Church, and have the privilege today of helping us think about what Scripture has to teach us. In fact, we're starting a new series of sermons today, and we're calling them Our Walk with God in a Post-COVID World. Things are not going to get back to normal, at least not the normal that we know. And there's all sorts of big issues that will be affecting our churches, and we want over the next few weeks to look at some of these themes and see what Scripture teaches about them. Some of them will be headed with the word life. So we'll look at life before death. There's been a lot of talk about death. Of course, we see the figures every day being published. So let's see what Scripture says about life before death. We're going to look at life when there is financial uncertainty. And that's certainly going to be true in the future. And some of them are titled A New Opportunity. We're going to look at a new opportunity to speak of our faith, because there is a wide open door for us as Christians to talk about Jesus in the present pandemic. But today's theme, which comes on that new opportunity listing, is a new opportunity to serve our parish. We're an Anglican church. If you're listening in from, watching in from outside, we have a parish, an area of land around us, a population, I think, of about 6,000, and we have a responsibility for them. So apply it to your own church if you're not part of St Albans. But what is a new opportunity for us that COVID is giving us to serve our parish? And I want to do this in two different ways. First of all, by looking at a Bible theme and seeing what that teaches. And secondly, looking at a Bible passage and seeing what that teaches. And then applying that to how we serve our parish. So we're going to start with the Bible theme. And the theme I want us to study is the theme of compassion. There are notes available as with me. They'll be on the website shortly within the media section. And you can look up all these verses on the printed notes if you'd like to. It may be helpful. But we're going to look at the theme of compassion. And there are 86 references to that, I discover, in the New International Version of the Bible, in Old Testament and New. If you then add in the word that's translated mercy, a very similar word, there's 150 more. So this idea of compassion, which is not that common a word in our English language, we don't use it that often, has a lot of use in Scripture. So let's do a very, very quick flip through of what they're saying. 3 points to make here. Firstly, God is a God of compassion. That comes right the way through the Old Testament. Just to give you two very well-known psalms, for example, Psalm 51, you'll know it, starts, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions." This is David, just after the Bathsheba incident, screaming, as it were, to God for forgiveness and reminding him that he's a God of compassion. Or another very well-known psalm, Psalm 103, which starts, "Praise the Lord, my soul," and goes on in verse 4, "who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion." Yes, God's compassion for people. And a bit later on, verse 13, "As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him." The idea of a father having this love in action for his children. Or if you go on to Isaiah, there's plenty of references in Isaiah. Here's one, Isaiah 49, verse 13, "Shout for joy, you heavens, for the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones." So we're taught in the Old Testament that God is a God of compassion, of loving action, of who does something, who not only loves, but shows it in practice and has mercy on people. Secondly, when we go to the New Testament, we find that Jesus had compassion, especially for the crowds. One, again, well-known passage here, Matthew chapter 9. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus saw the crowds without leadership, without proper teaching, and of course his compassion meant that he taught, he healed, he forgave, and he fed on some occasions. And then he taught also, of course, in the parable of the prodigal or the lost son, in Luke 15, verse 20, the father, do you remember the story? The son's gone off, gone into this far country, and then decides to come back. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him, was filled with compassion for him, and ran to his son and threw his arms around him. Jesus' teaching of the father's compassion again here. It's a central theme in many ways. God is a God of compassion. Secondly, Jesus had compassion. And thirdly, that then gets applied to us through the cross. We have seen, if we're a Christian, we have seen God's compassion for us in forgiving us through Jesus' death. So St. Paul teaches in Ephesians chapter 2, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy," the word used here is mercy, it's the same idea as compassion. "God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions." And then we are taught by Paul in his letter to the Colossians that we must show this mercy and compassion too. And so we have, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion." So this is a key Bible theme. And it is talking about God's love in action, shown through the Old Testament, through Jesus' ministry, to us in the cross, and we are to show it too. So that's my Bible theme, compassion. My Bible story comes from Luke chapter 10, and we'll have that read now.
I'm reading Luke 10, 25 to 37, the story of the Good Samaritan. Then an expert on the law stood up to test Jesus, saying, "Teacher, what must I do to get eternal life?" Jesus said, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" The man answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind. Also, love your neighbour as you love yourself." Jesus said to him, "Your answer is right. Do this and you will live." But the man, wanting to show the importance of his question, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbour?" Jesus answered, "As a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, some robbers attacked him. They tore off his clothes, beat him, and left him lying there almost dead. It happened that a Jewish priest was going down that road. When he saw the man, he walked by on the other side. Next, a Levite came there, and after he went over and looked at the man, he walked by on the other side of the road. Then a Samaritan, travelling down the road, came to where the hurt man was. When he saw the man, he felt very sorry for him. The Samaritan went to him, poured olive oil and wine on his wounds, and bandaged them. Then he put the hurt man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he cared for him. The next day, the Samaritan brought out 2 silver coins, gave them to the innkeeper and said, 'Take care of this man. If you spend more money on him, I will pay it back to you when I come again.' Then Jesus said, 'Which one of these 3 men do you think was a neighbour to the man who was attacked by the robbers?' The expert on the law answered, 'The one who showed him mercy.' Jesus said to him, 'Then go and do what he did.'"
Well, thank you for that reading. So there we have a story that Jesus tells about being nice to people we don't get on with. Well, no, there's a lot more to it than that. What's happening is a clever lawyer is testing Jesus, wanting him to walk into a trap and say something that would be heretical. And in the doing of this, he is completely outmaneuvered by our Lord. He quotes a verse from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, which says you are to love your neighbour. But of course, the lawyer relates that to his Jewish neighbour because he's a Jew. And Jesus very cunningly turns the whole thing round the other way. Instead of talking about who is his neighbour, says who was neighbour in the story to the Jewish man who was stuck in, left for dying in the ditch. So what happens is you've got this person on this road from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he falls among thieves. And that would have happened would be quite a common thing in those days on that dangerous road. He's left for dead at the side of the road. And 2 temple officials come along, and both of them know that if they touch a dead man, they're unclean. And so they walk by on the other side. And then a Samaritan, a hated Samaritan. The Samaritans were loathed by the Jewish people in those days. And he comes along and goes over, tends the man, cares for him, uses his own money to pay for him to be left at an inn, and goes out of his way to express compassion and mercy to this man who is in real need. And Jesus then turns to the lawyer and says, well, who then was the person who showed that he was a neighbour? And the lawyer is absolutely stuck. He has to answer, well, the one who had mercy, who showed compassion. So Jesus says, go and do likewise. And what Luke is trying to show, as he does throughout the whole of his gospel, is that Jesus has compassion for everybody, that this is not just for the Jewish faith, but for everybody. And anybody in need is our neighbour. So what does it say to us? It's not just a nice story, a Sunday school story. I believe as Christians, this has a real sting in the tail for us. Because like the lawyer, we have to ask ourselves, as it were, well, who is my neighbour? And am I prepared to go to the length that the Samaritan did to show compassion to other people? Let me take an illustration from our garden. We have a visitor to our garden, comes in quite often each week, and we love him very much indeed. And I've got a picture of him here, if you can see him. I don't know if you can work out what that is, but we've called him Percy. And Percy is a partridge. You'll often see him walking up and down the verge in Sandridge Road outside our house. We don't quite know where he belongs, but he comes to us now quite regularly. And we love him, we feed him, we give him RSBP food, and we look after him and love having him. We also have a pear tree in our garden, and I'm longing for the day when I can take a picture of the partridge in the pear tree, but that's another issue. Now, I also, in my garden, grow dahlias, and the great enemy of dahlias are slugs, because slugs love to chomp on dahlia leaves. Now, this year's been good. It was dry earlier on, and that means there are very few slugs around. But in previous years, I've had to go out at night, at 10 o'clock at night, with a torch, round the dahlia plants, looking for slugs, picking them off and disposing of them. I won't say how, because that's the only way to let the dahlias grow. So can you see how I have selected people, or not people, but animals, in the garden who I want to be, as it were, neighbour? I'm very happy to help the partridge, but I'm not happy to help the slugs. I have made a natural selection. And that's exactly what the lawyer was doing. He was selecting people to be his neighbour. And my worry and concern is that as Christians, do we do the same? Are we in danger of choosing people to be our neighbours, the people that we will help and go out and give aid to? But the parable teaches that we give aid to anyone who is in need. It's not just being kind. Now let's apply all this looking at, first of all, compassion, and secondly, thinking about who our neighbour is. And let's apply that to ourselves in a COVID or a post-COVID world. Well, I believe there's going to be a huge need, certainly in our parish, but in the whole community. We're going to see massive unemployment in future. That's almost certain. We're going to see much more poverty, much more than we see in the food bank at the moment. We're going to see, I believe, fear and concern and worry at a future that is far less stable and certain than we have known until now. And we need to have compassion, because we serve a God of compassion, to people who are our neighbours, who, as we've seen, is anybody in need. Now, in our parish, we already do quite a bit. We run the shack on Fridays when we can. We run big lunches and equivalent. We help with the food bank. Some of our members seek prayer information from people living in various streets. The seniors group offers help and support. And of course, we have very limited human resources as a church, but we do have a great building. But I'm wondering if this theme of compassion and this teaching on neighbours from Jesus is saying something to us, that perhaps we ought to be promoting, making ourselves better known in the parish, going out more from our walls of our church building, rather than in times of need retreating into that building. Perhaps we should be raising major sums of money for local needs and local projects. I don't know. But I wonder if God is saying something to us through this thinking about compassion or mercy and neighbours, about how we should be using the COVID situation to serve our parish more. I hope the PCC is going to take the whole of this series of sermons seriously, because I'm sure all sorts of actions will come out. But here is one issue that I hope they will take seriously. How should we be serving our parish when we're called to be compassionate to all in need? Just take those two words, compassion and neighbour. Think about them, mull them over, and think what we as a church should be doing. And to help do that, we're going to give some discussion questions on these sermons in this series. And here are the three coming up, I hope, on the screen now, discussion questions for this particular one. First of all, how can we develop real compassion for our parish's needs? How can we develop real compassion for our parish's needs? Secondly, how can we communicate that we care, that we want to be supportive, not on our terms, but on other people's terms, to those who live in our parish? And then what practical action would you like to see us taking to put that into practice, given that we have limited resources, but knowing that we have an obligation to serve those in need? There's three questions. Mull them over in your family. Think about them. And I hope the PCC will tackle them in due course.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. I know we can't physically greet many people this morning, but in our hearts and minds, let's remember those that we miss, those who are absent, those that perhaps we need to talk to soon, those who need a word of encouragement, those that need a word of forgiveness. As we think of those things, let's move into our intercessions, and after that I'm going to display a short video during which I share the words of the Eucharistic prayer.
Good morning. There's been several nations on my heart to pray for this morning, so let's pray. Father, thank you that you are Lord. Jesus, thank you that you are victorious. And Lord, as we bring several different nations before you, we recognise that you are on the throne. And we glorify and praise you this morning. Lord, first of all, I want to bring before you Lebanon. Lord, this nation is currently going through economic crisis with hyperinflation and many people's savings being worth nothing and their wages being worth nothing in terms of being able to buy food. God, would you intervene? Lord, would you provide for the food that is needed? Lord, would you give wisdom to those that are distributing food? Would you give wisdom to the governmental leaders to make wise decisions about their economy? Father, we pray for the church leaders and the believers to be able to reach out and spread the gospel at this time and make you known among their neighbours and their people. In Jesus' name. Lord, I bring to you the nation of the United States of America, as they're facing many challenges right now, and not only with COVID-19, but also with the racial issues and other tensions. But Lord, at this time, I hear of so many stories of people coming to know you. So Lord, I want to pray for those that are hearing of you and faith is being birthed. Lord, we pray for a deep rooting of faith to stir in their hearts, that this would be a life-transforming moment for them, not just during this season of tension, but that the seed would grow and that there would be discipleship happening and a growth in their faith to really follow after you for the rest of their lives. Lord, we bless each one in the United States that has made a commitment to you at this time, that this would be a life-changing decision. God, I pray for Brazil at this time, where there are many that are suffering, having lost family members to the coronavirus, and God, we just want to cover all those that are grieving right now. God, would you be their comforter? Would you meet them in their time of need? Would you put a stop to this virus spreading more? And the final a nation is China, and particularly Hong Kong. Lord, we bring before you the people of Hong Kong, as there's a lot of uncertainty in their political situation. God, we ask for wisdom and guidance for them as they have to make decisions about their lives and decisions about how they move forward. God, we trust you to lead and guide. God, would you bring your justice in that region of the world? And Lord, we pray for ourselves. God, I want to pray for, just as we've heard in the sermon, God, that we would be people who would reach out, that we would be people who would notice and know how to serve our local community, know how to bring the gospel in a very practical way to meet the needs of those around us, whatever they may be. God, would you open our eyes to see, to be your salt and light in our local communities. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. O God, loving Father eternal, creator of all time and space, in this our own time and place, we give you thanks and praise for giving us life and inviting us to share in the history of a people who are blessed by your faithfulness, challenged by your prophets, forgiven by your mercy, and ever surprised by your power at work in us more than we can ask or imagine. Therefore, we join our voices with the voices of all you have created, all you have loved, and all you sustain to praise you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We thank you for your life manifest in our brother Jesus, bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh, whose life, death, and resurrection reveal you fully, your love for humanity, your desire for human freedom, your passion for justice. We remember that Jesus gathered at table with his friends in a time of struggle and fear, took bread, blessed it, and gave it to them, saying, Take and eat, for this is my body given for you. And after supper, Jesus, looking forward to your desired day of joy and power, took the cup of wine, blessed it, and said, Take this, all of you, and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. I will share this meal with you again in the reign of God. Share this bread and this cup in memory of me. Let us proclaim together the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Come now, Holy Spirit of God, as you were present at creation, be present now. And let these gifts of bread and cup become for us the bread of life and the cup of blessing. As you were sent by Jesus to accompany us on our journey of faith, be present now and make this community, in receiving this bread and cup, one body in Christ. And so we say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Sisters and brothers, receive the body of Christ, which was broken for you, and his blood, which was shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Please do take the opportunity now to share the bread and wine amongst yourselves, whoever is present with you at the moment. If you need to pause, then please do. And once we come back, then we're going to move towards the conclusion of our service by singing together again. Thank you.
river flows into my heart, awakens love, makes me new, it stirs my heart.
Next week, August the 9th, there will be a short communion service here at Christ Church Centre at 9:15, so please do come to that if you can, and certainly talk about it amongst those that you might know who would like to come, especially those who can't get to the, who can't access the online stuff. We are continuing to do the online stuff, and indeed if people want to stay after the communion, we will be watching it together. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his dear Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you and all those for whom you pray, now and forever. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.